usual, the castaway is introduced by Roy Plumley.
On our desert island this week is the actress Wendy Hiller. Miss Hiller, could you endure loneliness, prolonged loneliness?
No, I don't think I could. I think it would be a torment to me. I like to be alone. In fact, it's very necessary for me to be alone at certain times. But to be quite alone would be real loneliness, and that's something quite different. I really don't know how I should sustain it.
What would you be happiest to have got away from?
Noise.
Is music important in your life?
I always feel rather apologetic. I feel like saying I'm not as important as it should be. People and people's voices are more important to me. I think I should feel bereft in life without any music. But music isn't such a large piece of my life.
Did you have any overall plan in choosing these records?
I thought to myself, everything for me would be association.
Yeah.
Everything would be evocative. Everything would bring back a piece of my life, a large part of my life that was important to me.
What's the first one?
Now, the first one is a brass band or a silver band, which I think is typical of the North, and somehow reminds me of my childhood when in the summer at fetes or flower shows there would always be a band, and also in the winter on New Year's Day, which was my mother's birthday and which was a holiday in those days in the North, a general holiday, and everything seemed to always be quiet on New Year's Day and very still and very frosty, and up the lane would come very slowly the sound of the brass band.
Smiling Morn, played by the Grimthorpe Colliery Band. What's your second record?
Well, now my second record is Schubert's Unfinished Symphony. It belongs to me very much to a next stage in my life when I was coming to music and also to cricket through the writings of Neville Cardiff on the Manchester Guardian. And it was only the other day that I was reading an article of his in the Guardian. And Neville Carter said about this unfinished symphony that if we were to die and waken to hear such music, we could all be confident that after all, we had arrived in the right place. And that seemed to cover everything about Schubert's Unfinished for me and being alone on an island. And that's a record I should want.
closing passage of Schubert's Unfinished Symphony, Otto Klemperer conducting the Philharmonia Orchestra. Miss Hilly, you said you were from the north. What part of the north?
Yes, I'm from Lancashire, from a suburb of Manchester.
Yes. As a child, did you see a lot of theatre?
No, really, very little. But I always knew I wanted to go into the theatre. I came of an untheatrical family. I was sent away to boarding school in the south. And I had a voice training teacher there who was a remarkable woman, Miss Edith Clements, who is still alive, a wonderful woman. And I think she took it for granted, really, that I should go into the theatre.
How did you start?
I went to the, what was known as the Rusham Rep, Repertory Theatre, which was a sort of inner suburb of Manchester.
Yes.
And being paid 30 shillings a week, I was a sort of assistant stage manager. I worked long hours,
yes.
10 in the morning, and long hours, which was wonderful.
Mm-hmm. What was the first appearance, the first time you trod the boards?
Well, I trod the boards. They used to turn butler's parts into maids for me because, you see, I could ASM and play the butler dressed as a maid.
Yes, right.
So that was quite easy. So I played a lot of maids,
mm-hmm.
with various acts. In fact, I grew out of the maid's frock there. There was only one. I grew and got rather plump.
Yes.
And so that was, I think, for somebody who wasn't lucky enough to go to RADA or any training school, a quite wonderful training because it was the practical way.
How long did you stay there?
I think I was there, for over 2 years. And then I went back to play Love on the Dole,
mm-hmm.
which was the beginning of what is known as success.
Yes, that was your big chance, Love on the Dole.
That was what is known as my big chance, which I played 7 months on tour twice nightly, then in London and then in New York.
Yes.
It was then that I met my husband, Ronald Gow, who had adapted Walter Greenwood's novel and put it onto the stage.
Yes. Well, these were the days of the Depression, of course, and the story. Love on the Dole made a really enormous impact everywhere it played.
It made an enormous impact, and although we played the small towns of Lancashire and Yorkshire, and although the audiences were seeing themselves in a way, it was an incredible success.
Yes. It didn't do very much in New York, if I remember right.
I left it. I can't really remember. I think I was lucky enough to have a personal success. I came back from there to play St. Joan at the Malvern Festival for GBS's 81st birthday. I don't know quite how it worked out, but I did get a telegram from Barry Jackson asking me if I'd like to play Elizabeth Doolittle, which I always think was rather strange, rather quaint, and St. Joan.
Gorgeous double.
Yes, and I came back and did them both. We were doing four plays, and I was in those two rather large parts. And so I managed them both with 6 rehearsals and 1 dress rehearsal, which is something you do when you're very young and very brave.
I should think so. And Eliza Doolittle, of course, you also played in the film version.
Yes, which came just before the war.
Yes, it was one of the most successful films ever made in a British studio, I should think. Mm. Who was in it with you? Leslie Howard?
That was Leslie Howard and all sorts of wonderful people.
Mm.
I was the only unknown one.
And then you did another Shaw film.
And then I did another Shaw film, but that was a couple of years later, and that took a long time. That was during the war. That was Major Barbara.
Yes. Let's break off here for your third record. What will that be?
Now, my third record will be Delius, In a Summer Garden. And if you're going to ask me why, I'll tell you that during the war, we were living in Wales on the island of Anglesey, and I have a memory of summer evenings when my husband would put on In a Summer Garden, the record, and the bombers were going up to bomb Liverpool. And it all seemed so hopeless. The noise of the planes going up past us, past the island, or coming back.
Mm.
And this music somehow seemed to make things seem a little more real. The music was the real thing, and the planes up in the sky weren't quite real. Not to me, anyway.
Mm-hmm. In a Summer Garden by Delius, played by the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Sir Thomas Beecham. Now, during the war, I know you toured for Seema. Just after the war, you made a very pleasant film set in Scotland. What was that?
Oh, yes. It was the film we made in the Hebrides called I Know Where I'm Going.
And you were in a very successful play about the Prince Regent.
Oh, yes. Norman Ginsbury, The First Gentleman. The First Gentleman.
Right.
It was Robert Morley.
Yes,
yes, yes. That's it. Very jolly.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, royalty in the kitchen.
Yes.
You know, the public always likes that.
Yes.
Royalty with taking down its back hair. It was a charming play.
And then you had a long run at the Haymarket Theatre.
Oh, yes, that was with Dame Sybil and Dame Edith. The Waters of the Moon, you
Waters
mean?
Waters of the Moon, that's
yes.
Right.
A delicious play by my friend Norman Hunter.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, a much underrated playwright.
And then a season at the Old Vic. What did you play there?
Oh, now, what did I play? Not very successfully. Hermione. You know, that old statue.
Winter's Tale.
Tale.
Mm-hmm.
Then I rather enjoyed Amelia. Yes, I wore a black wig for Amelia. And then came very happily to Tyrone Guthrie's production of Troilus and Cressida.
Yes.
Playing a rather surprising Helen of Troy. Rather like an old Claire de Beau.
You had quite a long spell in the United States. Several years.
Well, I used to go to America, having played in Love on the Dole there when I was very young.
Yes.
Then I played the heiress. I had several very happy visits there. It's a country I love to visit, and it's been very kind to me.
Yes, and you made some films. You made Separate Tables, for which you got an Academy Award.
Ah, that we made in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
But we all went over for that. We outnumbered the Americans 7-2.
It was a lovely story that you had a psychiatrist on the set. I mean, not for you personally.
No, but we did.
Yes.
But for me personally, to explain to me why it was better for the play for Rita Hayworth to play my best scene with Deborah Carr.
That must have needed a bit of explaining.
Well, it didn't. It did, really. I rather lost my sense of humor for about half an hour.
I can imagine. Still, you've got that beautiful, rare, and prestigious Academy Award.
Yes, well, it was a lovely film to do, and Terence Rattigan writes such beautiful stuff.
He's such a wonderful craftsman, Rattigan.
Perfect craftsmanship, and a perfect sense of the theater.
Let's have your next record. What's that?
Now, my next record is Kathleen Ferrier singing. I wouldn't really mind what Kathleen Ferrier sang as long as she sang.
Now for the living, all her sweetness gone. It lifted to the bosom of the lake.
Quilters, Now Sleeps the Crimson Petal, sung by Kathleen Ferrier. You've been in three plays by your husband, Ronald Gough.
Have I? Yes.
Well, Love on the Dole.
Anne Veronica.
Yes.
Yes, H.G. Wells' Anne Veronica and Hardy's Tess of the D'Urbervilles.
That's right. And you've been in three plays based on Henry James stories.
The Heiress, Wings of a Dove, and then I played the Aspen Papers in New York.
Yes.
Yes. I'm very much admire Henry James' writing, and I really do enjoy working my way through those long, slow, involved and convolvulated stories.
Yes.
And sentences. Sometimes you have to read a sentence 3 or 4 times, but once you've got it, you feel that it couldn't be put in any other way.
Mm-hmm. You had some very good film parts recently. A Man for All Seasons.
Oh, yes. That was a lovely film to do. It was a beautiful play and transferred to the screen, I think, very beautifully. And, of course, Paul Scofield's quite impeccable and memorable performance, which we all felt so desperately that we wanted to support to get it on to celluloid.
And David Copperfield, Mrs. Micawber.
Mrs. Micawber, what is known as a nice change.
What have you been doing just recently?
Now, what have I been doing? I've just finished touring Ghosts, Mrs. Alving.
Yes.
And,
You've just done a television.
Well, it was last summer that I made Clochemel in France, BBC serial.
Of course, yes.
Which, as I'd never been to France before, only to Paris, was a delightful experience.
Mm-hmm.
I was in France for a month, working very hard.
Yes.
Lovely weather, lovely wine.
Let's have another record.
Well, then, we choose John Gielgud, because feeling that I'd want another human voice occasionally on the island, I think that John Gielgud's speaking of the English language and speaking Shakespeare's sonnets would be the epitome of perfection of the spoken word for me.
When in this my outcast state, and trouble deaf heaven with my bootless cries, and look upon myself and curse my fate, wishing me like to one more rich in hope, featured like him with friends possessed, desiring this man's art and that man's scope, with what I most enjoy, contented least, yet in these thoughts myself almost despising. Haply I think on thee, and then my state, like to the lark at break of day arising from sullen earth, sings hymns at heaven's gate. For I, sweet love remembered, such wealth brings, that then I scorn to change my state with kings.
Sir John Gielgud. Which brings us to number six.
Which would be the Elgar Violin Concerto with Yehudi Menuhin playing it when he was a boy.
To the first movement of the Elgar Violin Concerto, with the composer conducting and Yehudi Menuhin as soloist. How efficient would you be as a desert island castaway? Could you look after yourself? Could you build a shelter of some sort?
Yes, I suppose I could if I was driven to it. I always let people do things for me if they're there to do them. But I suppose I'd up and do something.
Yes.
Could
you live off the land?
Yes, I don't think I'd be too bad at that.
You are a keen gardener, I believe, for a start.
A keen gardener, so I'd be digging and delving and taking cuttings and growing seeds. And I think my very muddled and very ineffective yearnings towards vegetarianism would really come into effect.
Yes.
Because I don't see myself off slaughtering animals, skinning and eating.
Would you try to escape?
Oh, I should think so. Oh, yes, I should think so.
If a raft was washed up.
Oh, I think I would, you know. I think I'd make plans. I'm quite good at plans, making lists. I might lose the list.
Do you know anything about small boats?
Nothing at all. Now, they have no sense of direction.
You sure you're wise? Record number 7.
Well, I think it would have to be a Chopin prelude, preferably played by Arthur Rubinstein. And the one I'd choose to have, if I could only have one, would be the prelude number 4 in E minor, because Dame Sybil in Water to the Moon, which we were talking about earlier, who is, Dame Sybil is, as you probably know, a considerable pianist.
Indeed.
She used to play very beautifully this prelude while we played a scene together. And for 2 years, 2 months, that wonderful woman played that beautiful music 8 times a week while we played the scene. And it was a part of my life for which I'm very grateful. And that piece of music would bring back a very happy time.
Prelude number 4 in E minor, played by Arthur Rubinstein.
I met Arthur Rubinstein some years ago. I was in New York. I was by myself. And when I say by myself, my husband couldn't come with me. And it was New Year's Eve, and I was invited to a party. And I was feeling extremely homesick and very lonely. And I was introduced to Mr. Rubinstein, which was a great joy to me. And he was very cordial and suggested a toast. And I said, with tears in my eyes, I don't really feel very happy. I feel so lonely without my husband and my family. And he put his glass down and he put both his arms around me and said, I know, in that lovely accent, I know just how you feel. Because when I am away from my family, I feel the same. I cannot bring your family to you, but I have here my wife, who I love so dearly. I am going to bring my wife to you, because I love her, and I know you will appreciate our love on this New Year's Eve. And he brought his charming wife, and they both put their arms round me, as though I was some foundling.
Yes.
At this very smart New York party.
A sweet man. Let's have your last disc now. What's that?
Now, my last disc is, it's a Scotch lament, The Flowers of the Forest, because I think it sort of epitomizes all those rather folksy Kennedy Fraser, Gaelic, Highland, Hebridean, Wales.
Thank you.
Flowers of the Forest, sung by Barbara Dixon. If you could take just one disc of your eight, which would you choose?
Sir John reading Shakespeare's sonnets.
And one luxury to take with you?
The large picture. It is Stanley Spencer's Cookham Resurrection.
Mm-hmm.
The one that used to be in the Tate. I don't know if it is now.
Probably still is. Anyway, we'll arrange to get it for you somehow. And one book apart from the Bible and Shakespeare.
I'm going to settle for Parson Woodford's diaries. He lived from 1758 to 1802, and from a student at Oxford, he kept diaries. So one gets the whole of his life and his family's lives, and his friends' lives, and his acquaintances' lives, and the life of rural England of the late 18th century.
It sounds a fascinating work. Parson Woodford's diaries. And thank you, Wendy Hiller, for letting us hear your Desert Island discs.